So let me start by saying thank you for inviting me here to give this paper, and it's joint with Livio Di Leonardo. This paper starts with a very simple observation, which is a new important feature of the international arena or international politics is what people were calling ungoverned spaces. These are these regions of the world, Syria, northern Iraq, northern Africa, the list goes on, that are not just ineffectively governed, they're essentially not governed at all. And these ungoverned spaces have given an opportunity to emerging non-state groups who have some political ambitions that they've yet been able to realize. And so an important question in foreign policy is, what are these non-state groups doing? What is it they want to accomplish once they've had a chance to consolidate? So there are basically two views for a non-state group. For one non-state group, people say either they're trying to consolidate control of territory. They exist somewhere where there's no effective state, and they're trying to provide that. That's the proto-state view. The other view that's popular in discourse now is that this is the next generation of global terrorism. So radicals all over the world who now have trouble finding haven in states because, you know, this is costly for states to house terrorists, now go to these ungoverned spaces because they're able to do the things that they want to do so that they can eventually implement a campaign of global terror. And so an important question is determining what these goals are, what these groups want to do, so that we can design foreign policy around it. So what are some of the foreign policy challenges? Well, obviously there's a pressing need to address evolving terrorist threats. If this is indeed the next generation of global terrorism, we need to understand and adapt to that. That doesn't need to be stressed on a day like today. The other is the uncertainty about the ultimate goals. Are they trying to control territory, or do they intend eventually to try to implement some campaign of global terror? It's important to determine what these are, but policymakers in charge of counterterrorism are uncertain about this. Another important feature is that these groups are not monolithic actors. They have internal political dynamics that we don't fully understand. So are there moderates involved? Are there extremists involved? And this is an important aspect in terms of just trying to figure out what are the ultimate goals of this organization? How will they deal with their own internal political problems? And from policymakers' perspectives, they're forced to rely on what these groups do to determine what they intend to do. So you might just say, well, can we just look at what they're doing and say, these people are trying to attract foreign fighters, they're trying to radicalize individuals over the internet. Isn't that a decent sign that they intend to carry out some kind of campaign of global terror? Is that simple intuition enough? And you might imagine that I'm going to tell you, no, it's not. In fact, I'm going to go through, we're going to develop a little model, very simple model, but we're going to try to understand when does that simple intuition hold, and more interestingly, when that simple intuition doesn't hold, how should we think about things? How should we think about these non-state groups? There's some papers, I'm not going to talk about them in detail. So, as I told you. So, what are the questions I'm going to talk about today? So, first, what can the authorities in potential targeted countries, countries that are targets of global terror campaigns, learn from observing the actions of the groups when they take radical actions, when we look at their internal politics? What can we infer from that? Can target countries exploit internal divisions within these groups to get rid of threats to national security? The big part of the debate now is, can we rely on moderates who are more interested in controlling territory than in taking extremist actions and intend to be part of a larger campaign? Another question, does a more aggressive approach deter groups from planning terror campaigns? So if they say, well, if we're going to invite international intervention, boots on the ground, if that threat of boots on the ground, is it an effective deterrent, or when is it an effective deterrent? And are inflexible and committed strategies a better tool to combat terrorist threats? So the big debate now is over drawing a line in the sand, or a red line, and sticking to that. Is that going to be an effective deterrent, or when is that an effective deterrent? Okay, so I'm going to develop a simple model to try to understand how these incentives interact and how this affects the politician's ability to combat terrorism. So we're going to start with a non-state group. This non-state group is composed of an incumbent faction and an elite faction. The wording's slightly odd, but an incumbent faction is the faction or group that's initially in control of the resources of this group. The elite faction is a different, perhaps different faction that can ultimately decide who's going to control the group later on and control the resources of the group later on. Each faction can either be moderate, so it's a parameter theta I. If it's zero, you're moderate. If it's one, you're extremist. This is very simple. You can actually extend the model to have more preference types, but just to get a simple intuition to understand how this works, I want to keep the model very simple. So there's a very sharp disagreement over how the resources of this group should be used. Moderates want to use the resources of the group for one aim. Extremists want to use the resources of the group for a different aim. Terrorism, I'm going to talk about the technology and how that occurs in a minute, but the payoff function for an individual faction, you have terrorism and you have other political tactics. And as you can see, it's parameterized in such a way that extremists care about terrorism, moderates care about other political tactics, which could be violent. It's not necessarily that these tactics are not violent, they're just not an issue of global terrorism. And there's going to be a preference composition of the group. The group can be cohesive, in which case both the incumbent and elite faction are extremists. They want to implement a campaign of global terror. It can be divided and initially led by an extremist. So the extremist faction initially controls the group's resources, but there's an elite faction who has some say in who's going to ultimately control this group or its resources, and divided and led by a moderate. So the moderate faction controls the group's resources, but there's an extremist element within the group who can cause trouble for the moderate. You can extend the model to have a cohesive moderate group. That's done in an appendix. It's fairly straightforward. In addition to this non-state group with these factions inside of it, there's a politician. The politician is uncertain of the preference composition of the group. And so he has these probabilities, mu c, mu e, mu m, of these different preference compositions. And that's the politician's beliefs about the group that he's facing. And the politician wants to stop global terrorism. His utility function is very simple, minus the level of global terrorism. Politicians' options are they can militarily intervene. So this is a fully interventionist policy, so-called boots on the ground. There's a cost of intervention to the politician, that's little c, that's what the politician has to pay in order to militarily intervene to try to eliminate the non-state group. And in addition, there's a cost of intervention to the factions that each faction bears. And this is the cost that they incur from having military intervention imposed on them. So they might be eliminated as a group. I'll talk about the technology of that in a second. But they pay a payoff cost from having to endure military intervention, regardless of whether or not it's successful. So the actions and the timing. First, the group is initially endowed with a unit resource. The incumbent faction is initially in control of this unit resource, and they can invest in a global terror network or not. This is capturing the fact that for a group who wants to implement global terror attacks, there's some investment involved. They have to recruit, fund, and they have to recruit and fund operatives all over the world. And this takes time to do, which makes them easier to detect. If the incumbent does not recruit, they're going to keep that resource and be able to use it later. The elite faction gets to observe, okay, did the incumbent recruit or not? How have they used our resources so far? And they get to decide whether they want to support that incumbent, keep that incumbent in charge of the group, or withdraw their support, in which case the power struggle will lead to a depreciation of the resource if they still have it. Delta is the parameter by which it depreciates the resource if there's a power struggle. For simplicity, we assume that if the elite faction withdraws support, they come to control of the group. You can relax that assumption as well, but to keep things simple, they're pivotal in determining who controls the group at the end of the game. The politician gets to see what has the incumbent done, what has the elite done, and they decide whether or not to intervene. If they intervene, they're able to eliminate the group with that probability. All that says is Q is the probability that if the politician intervenes, he eliminates the group, and phi is a parameter that represents how well does a group staying united instead of having a power struggle affect that probability. And it's very simple. So if the group remains united, so you have an elite or an incumbent faction and an elite faction who supports, they're harder to eliminate than a group that's had some power struggle, the incumbent faction is no longer part of the group, and you just have the elite faction. So staying united has a benefit in terms of reducing the effectiveness of international intervention. If the group survives, the faction in control, whether it's the elite faction or the incumbent faction, they're going to decide how to allocate the resources at the end of the game, whether they invest in global terrorism, local terrorism, or other political tactics. So I'm going to detail those now. So there's an allocation, X, Y, Z. Terrorism, there's two components to it. First is local terrorism. That's terrorism carried out at the local level. And then there's global terrorism, which is terrorism carried out outside of the borders or locale of this group. Local terrorism, very simple production technology. Beta captures how effective. If I allocate Y resources into local terrorism, beta determines how effective that is. Global terrorism is you have to have recruited, you have to have invested in being able to implement these attacks. And if you do, global terrorism is G of X. G of X has two components. First is this function gamma. It's increasing concave, all the standard things. If you allocate X into global terrorism, gamma of X is the level of terrorism that you implement. And gamma is a parameter that represents that having invested in radicalizing individuals, whether over the internet or attracting foreign fighters, you generally produce elements that you can't control. So this is called now like lone wolves. These are these people that are radicalized over things that are done on the internet, and they carry out attacks. And importantly, they're not under the direct control or supervision of the group. And so that parameter captures how this will influence the incentives of the non-state group, or extremists in particular, and the non-state group. Terrorism is just going to be the sum of these two pieces, very simple technology. And other political tactics, so what moderates want to do, if they invest Z in these other political tactics, L of Z tells us what is their return on Z. If you remember, the payoff function is very simple. So it's very simple to go through, see what the indirect utilities are, how they determine, well, if I keep a moderate in charge and I'm extremist, how unpleasant is that for me, given that he's not going to allocate the resources in a way that I want? So with these parameters, and with this model, I'm going to make a few restrictions just to keep the cases of interest. Do you have a question, Carl?
Yeah, the politician cares about all sorts of terrorism in the same way.
He cares about global terrorism, doesn't care about local terrorism, but the results are not terribly affected by it. It moves parameters around. Okay, so a few restrictions that I want to make on the model is, the first one is, a politician, if he knows that the group is led by extremists, probability one, he's going to want to intervene to try to eliminate that threat. So it means that the cost of intervention that the politician faces is low enough that he actually would intervene if he knew that there was a known threat. Extremist factions are actually interested in conducting global terror attacks. Formally, it corresponds to that. That's a boundary condition. It just says that if I had all the resources available in the game, which is normalized to two, I would rather put some of it into global terrorism than put it all into local terrorism if I knew the politician wasn't going to intervene. It just says that extremists would actually implement a global terror campaign if they could do it unencumbered. And the last is that intervention, military intervention, or boots on the ground, imposes large costs. And so for factions, the cost that they face from having military intervention kind of thrust on them is high enough that they can actually be deterred from things that they want to do. And the same thing for the politician. The cost that the politician faces from intervening is high enough that he actually can be deterred from using intervention if he's uncertain enough about whether the group is led by moderates or extremists. Okay, so what are the primary forces in the model? Set up a lot of pieces. There's really three main forces that drive the results in this model. So the first is without recruitment. So if the incumbent does not recruit, he's not investing in global terrorism, the elite faction will support if and only if the group is cohesive. What this says is that ideological differences between moderates and extremists are enough to bring a conflict over who controls that group or who controls the resources of that group. The second is if the group is divided, meaning that one faction's moderate, the other faction's extremist, and the incumbent has recruited, so now the politician cares what they're doing, then the elite supports if and only if. That's going to deter intervention. So these two things together tell you that intervention, or the threat of intervention, provides a common ground over which moderates and extremists can agree. And without it, that ideological division will bring that conflict to the surface. The last is an extremist incumbent of a divided group. So this is an extremist faction who initially controls the resources of the group, has a dominant strategy to recruit. They'll always recruit. And this shows you that the effect of lone wolves, or these elements that are produced as an effect of radicalization, have an effect on the incentives of factions who initially control the group. Okay, so let me go through the results. The first is, there's not a fully separating perfect Bayesian equilibrium. Which means the politician can never learn the ideological composition of the group. So it tells us that simple intuition of, let me just look to see what they're doing, what can I learn from that, is never quite going to hold. This result hinges a lot on that boundary condition. Two, that boundary condition fails, then you can get a fully separating equilibrium, but only when that's true. The intuition for this result is very simple. Factions choose their actions to generate uncertainty. They want to keep the politician uncertain. If moderates are able to signal to the politician that they're moderate, that will dissuade the politician from intervening if he knows that they're moderate, but then extremists want to look like moderates, gives them an incentive to mimic moderates. And what we're going to see in a minute is the extent of this uncertainty depends a lot on the cost of intervention that the politician faces or incurs. And this suggests that foreign policy with regard to non-state groups is always potentially a challenge, because the politician, when looking at non-state groups, is never fully going to know what the composition or the preference composition of that group is. He's never fully going to be able to understand what they want to do. Okay, so let's suppose now that the politician's cost that they incur from using military intervention is relatively high. Formally, there's just a cutoff C hat. If the cost the politician faces or incurs from military intervention is higher than that C hat, there exists a unique semi-separating perfect Bayesian equilibrium where only extremist incumbents recruit and no elite faction ever supports.
So, just for clarification, that's the unique PVE or the unique
semi-separating? Semi-separating. It's not the unique. There's a pooling one, which I'm going to do in a second. So what this says is, in this equilibrium, recruitment signals the ideology of the incumbent. The fact that the politician has seen these efforts at radicalizing individuals, pulling in foreign fighters, blah, 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 it's going to signal that the incumbent faction is extremist, and if they retain control of the group, will use their resources to conduct a campaign of global terror. But in this case, the moderate, if the group is divided, the elite faction, who can unseat that incumbent faction, wants to signal that they're moderate, but then, of course, the extremist wants to mimic this moderate. And what this says is cohesive extremist groups. This is a group where both factions are extremist, they want to conduct global terrorism, will strategically project an image of divisions so as to fool the politician on some level, make the politician think, well, it's likely enough that there's an internal division within this group that because I'm relatively reluctant to intervene, that will dissuade the politician from intervention. And this works out for both groups. The moderates are happy because now they control the group and they get to allocate the group's resources as they want. And the extremist faction is happy because that uncertainty that the politician faces is sufficient to dissuade that politician from intervention. And now they get to do what they want with the resources. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about the pooling equilibrium. There exists a unique pooling perfect Bayesian equilibrium where both moderate and extremist incumbents recruit, and both moderate and extremist elites support. And if C is below that cutoff from the previous proposition, that's the unique perfect Bayesian equilibrium. Pure strategy, perfect Bayesian equilibrium. So what this says, the politician, so now the politician wants to intervene if the group is divided. He sees that internal division, that conflict within the group, means that intervention is more effective. It's more likely to eliminate the group and eliminate the threat. And the politician wants to intervene if they see that division. The incumbent faction, both moderate and extremist, want to exploit this readiness of the politician to respond to divisions. Incumbents are going to exploit that to quell internal disagreements. They're basically going to present the elite faction with an ultimatum. I've recruited. This guy's coming in if you don't support me, and that's costly. That's something you want to avoid, so you should support me so as to avoid that costly intervention. Moderate elites are going to support extremists in this case because they want to avoid that intervention. And more interestingly, moderate incumbents of a divided group are going to recruit for global terror so as to quell that internal disagreement in the group. They know that the only way that they can keep control of the group is by bringing the attention of the politician. The politician's looking at the group and saying, if I see divisions because this guy's recruited, I'm going to intervene, and the extremists will support so as to avoid that intervention. If that moderate had instead not recruited, since they don't really care about global terrorism in the first place, they would not have been supported. They would have lost control of the group, and they would not have been able to allocate the resources in the way that they wanted to anyway. And so what moderates are doing here is they're projecting an image of extremism to try to quell these internal problems that they face within the group. And that's because the threat of international intervention provides this common ground on which extremists and moderates, who otherwise don't agree on much of anything, provides that common ground on which they can agree, let's try to avoid this intervention. Okay, so we have two different kinds of equilibrium in this model. There's a pooling equilibrium that exists over all the range of costs, and if the cost is low, so the politician is kind of willing to use military intervention, it's the unique equilibrium. And then we have this other equilibrium where if the cost is high, then the politician's able to get some information because he's going to bring some conflicts to the surface. In fact, he's going to create conflicts where there weren't initially conflicts. So we can ask a question. Because the politicians who are willing to intervene are being exploited by these groups are using the politician's readiness to intervene to quell their own internal political problems. Because the politician's being, you know, exploited in this fashion, we can ask the question, might the politician do better by committing to strategies that aren't responsive to these kind of internal politics of the group? If he just ignores, okay, the elite didn't support his support, I'm just not going to pay attention to that. Might he do better? So I'm going to look at two different strategies and evaluate the welfare of the politician. When is the politician better off? Since the politician's preferences are minus the level of global terrorism, we're going to look at how does the politician reduce terrorism more effectively? And can he do better by not using his beliefs about the internal composition of the group? So the two strategies I'm going to look at is one, the politician just commits to never use intervention. So he just takes boots on the ground off the table. We're never going to do that. And the second is a red line, where the politician is going to see recruitment, these efforts at radicalizing individuals, and he's going to immediately intervene with military force. He's not going to pay attention to whether he thinks the group's controlled by moderates or not. He's just going to intervene based on seeing that initial radicalization. And so if we look first at a reluctant politician, so that was just a politician whose cost of intervention is above that C hat, then that politician never benefits from taking intervention off the table. And he's only going to benefit from using a red line policy if the cost is not too high, because he's going to have to incur these costs on the path of play. So if he's using this kind of red line where he just responds, if it's an effective deterrent and his cost is not too high from using that, then it's beneficial. But you see, it's kind of a hard thing to find. Politician's cost is high, but it can't be too high. There is a range where you can find where that politician does benefit, and then there's also a range where that politician is better off responding to the internal politics of the group because he's able to bring those conflicts to the surface. But what about a willing politician? So this is a politician who has a relatively low cost of military intervention, and it turns out this politician, because he's being exploited by these groups, is better off using either strategy. So he's better off using that red line in an effort to deter the initial recruitment from a cohesive group, but he's also better off just taking military intervention off the table. And so what this suggests is that reluctance to intervene, a politician that needs to be fairly certain that the group is being led by extremists in order to use military intervention, can be a strategic advantage. A willingness to use military intervention is not an advantage because the groups will use that willingness to solve their own political problems. And that's because politicians who are reluctant to use military intervention are harder to exploit by these groups. Okay, so I'm a little ahead. So to summarize, the uncertainty in the internal politics of non-state groups, the fact that they're not monolithic actors, and it's hard to know who is exactly in charge, or is the group effectively a monolithic actor, is an important challenge for foreign policy, because politicians want to try to infer whether they can rely on moderates or whether they're producing these other effects. Use a very simple model to show you that factions will exploit and benefit from this uncertainty. The fact that the politician can't quite tell who's moderate and who's extremist provides an opportunity for divided groups or factions within divided groups to solve their own internal political problems. The model shows that cohesive groups will try to project an image of divisions, using the uncertainty of the politician to dissuade him from intervening because he's saying, oh, there's internal divisions. It's got to be that the moderates are doing this for me. At the same time, moderates want to project an image of extremism so as to bring the politician's attention to that group and use that to solve their own internal political problems. And last, hawkish politicians, it's kind of, I'm pushing it a little, I suppose, politicians with a relatively low cost of intervention. So these are politicians that are willing to use military intervention and ready to use military intervention, are better off drawing red lines and sticking to them. Don't pay attention to the politics of the group. And in fact, we show that they're even better off taking military intervention off the table and putting things in place that says they'll never use intervention. I mean, then they're not really hawkish, right? This is what I meant by pushing it. But. And a dovish position, a politician that's very reluctant to use military intervention, can be a strategic advantage because the non-state groups are not able to use that internal division to solve other internal political problems. Thanks.
Thank you. So thanks, Scott A, for inviting me. Thanks, Scott T, for a paper. So he's not left out. I can thank Scott G for, I don't know, being a nice guy and being a pioneer in formal theory and comparative politics, particularly in my areas. So my main comment on this paper is that it's written backwards. So I don't mean that they like start with Appendix D, but the way that the model is written, I think, should be actually just totally reversed. So the reason why they do this is we're sort of starting with this, is sort of in some ways, the elements of this model are pretty simple and pretty easy to understand, but it's also kind of hard to see how everything ties together, right? Because we've sort of got three actors, we've got two different actions which have signaling implications, we've got incomplete information, and so, you know, maybe the wise formal theorists can understand how it all sticks together, but for, I don't know, I'm a simplistic comparativist, I guess. And so it's sort of hard for me to kind of follow what was going on. And so I think it would be easier to start with this case where the foreign actor is not strategic, which is sort of the same as the commitment version. And so then we'll sort of start getting intuitions with that to sort of see how these internal group politics work. And then also I think you maybe want to add an intermediate stage where the foreign actor is a strategic actor, but has complete information, and then sort of add the incomplete information at the end. And I think that'll sort of help understand how things work. And then also sort of make a clearer comparison of how these issues of incomplete information actually matter. If we start with complete information, then say, okay, what happens when we drop that? So here's how I think the paper goes when you do this. And so let's sort of start at the end. So let's start with this game that's only played between the incumbent and challenger factions. So again, the incumbent's going to invest in this terrorism capacity. Do we go and recruit people on Twitter or not? And so this is going to have two effects. First, it's going to allow for this global terror technology later. And then we're also going to get this lone wolf activity no matter what we do later. So the challenger then is going to decide whether to, I'm also saying challenger rather than elite, I think it's sort of a maybe better terminology, is going to support the incumbent or not, and if they withdraw support, then resources get destroyed, the challenger takes over. Then there's going to be two cases we're considering now, we're going to consider first. First, there's sort of no chance of intervention, and then the second case we're going to consider is that just intervention happens exogenously if recruiting happens, right? And these are going to correspond to the two, what were called commitment cases before. And then sort of at the end, the leader is going to allocate the resources between local terror, global terror, if they've developed this capacity, and then just, you know, other stuff, state building, providing public goods, et cetera. So again, to review the faction types, we're going to have extremist factions who want to maximize terror. We're going to have moderate factions who want to do other stuff. And so I guess they show in the appendix you can do things where all four configurations are possible, but we're going to assume that there's at least one extremist. So what's going to happen at the end? So regardless of what happens leading up to the game. So in the last period, if we have a moderate in power, they're going to do all public goods. If we have an extremist in power, they're going to do all local terror if that's their only option. Otherwise, they're going to do some blend of local and global terror. So that's what's going to happen at the end, no matter what. And so the intervention decision for now is never going to be contingent on the support level. That's kind of by assumption. So we're just assuming that the intervention can only be conditioned on recruiting, not by support. And so that's going to have no implications on the support decision. So what's always going to happen is that a sort of congruent faction is going to support. We're both extremists. Why would I destroy resources? You're going to do what I want. But when we have divided factions, we're always going to see withdrawal of support, because I would rather kick you out. There's never going to be an intervention, and then I get to set the policy I want. So in the no intervention case, then recruitment also doesn't affect intervention. And so what's going to happen is that an extremist is going to recruit, because they sort of might as well generate some lone wolf activity, even if they're going to get kicked out. And the moderate isn't going to recruit. This is partly by assumption. They're actually indifferent, but that's fine. And so the overall outcome in this no intervention case is that if they're both extreme, we're going to get a bunch of terror, including global terror. If we have an extreme incumbent and a moderate challenger, we're going to get this lone wolf terror, because the incumbent is going to invest and generate the lone wolf activity. Then they get kicked out of power, and so we get no other global terror. And if we start with a moderate incumbent but then an extreme challenger, we're going to get lots of local terror, because the moderate is not going to make this investment. Then the extremist takes over. All they can do is just do a bunch of local terror. So this is sort of the easiest kind of baseline case to start with. So what happens if we add this condition that if you are to recruit, then there's going to be an intervention? So this actually doesn't change the cases where we have these divided factions. They're going to sort of do the same thing. They're going to do what they want at first, then they're going to get kicked out, then they're going to do what they want at the end. But so where things change is if we have two extreme factions, then this commitment to intervention now generates a trade-off, where if I recruit, that's going to trigger an intervention, but also gives me this additional technology later. And so there's going to be a trade-off where, so if the cost of intervention is low, I'm going to say, OK, it's worth it. I care enough about getting this global terror capacity. I'm going to invest even though you're going to intervene. And then if I survive, I'm going to do what I want. But if the cost of intervention is too high, then I'm better off just sort of restraining myself from investing. And then I'm just going to do a bunch of local terror. And so it's actually kind of interesting. This leads to more local terror. So by having this sort of red line saying, don't recruit, we're actually maybe making things worse off for people who are actually around where the terrorist group is. So now let's think about adding the politician as a strategic actor. And so again, they're going to be a strategic actor who's going to decide whether to intervene or not. And their goal is going to be to minimize global terror, and they're also going to pay some cost if they intervene. So again, the main analysis in the paper, we're going to assume this politician is uncertain about the composition of the terrorist groups. But again, I think to make the comparison more stark of what information does, let's maybe start by thinking about what happens if the politician does know the types, the foreign actor does know the types. So I think what happens, this is in the paper, so Scott can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think, so the politician is going to intervene if they're facing an extremist and recruitment happens. So they're actually not going to intervene in the case where we start with an extremist and they get replaced. There's no reason to intervene, even though there's this global terror network, because sort of the damage is already done, the lone wolves are out there, and the moderate isn't going to do any more global terror. So I think that's the difference in the intervention decision. But if we have both extremists, this is going to be the same as before. And if we start with a moderate incumbent and an extremist challenger, again, I think this doesn't actually change anything from this commitment to intervention case. So I think sort of, again, building up some scaffolding, so this having a strategic actor doesn't really change a whole lot from the commitment case as long as there's complete information. So sort of in the terminology of the paper, we're going to say that, so the politician's problem is kind of easy here, even though their elimination efforts might fail. So it's not like they necessarily get the best outcome, but there's sort of not this informational challenge. So now let's get to sort of the case that we start with is, now we're going to say the politician observes the recruitment and support decisions, but doesn't actually know the types of the factions. And so there, now we're just sort of what Scott's already presented. So we get this result where there's always going to be a pooling equilibrium where everyone recruits, everyone gets supported on the path, and we get no intervention as long as you're supported. And sort of Scott already ran through the intuition for this. But so notice what's changing is that the moderate faction is now recruiting, and the moderate faction is sort of now recruiting in order to sort of stave off a challenger from the extremist. So that's sort of one thing that's changing with the complete information. And the other thing that's changing is that we're now no longer getting intervention on the path. So even though we're now getting tons of recruiting, we're never going to actually intervene because the foreign politician doesn't know enough about the type's composition. So we're sort of going to get definitely more lone wolf terror, and I think probably more global terror, though that may depend on the type distribution. And then we also are going to have, sometimes we're going to have this semi-separating equilibrium where the extremist is going to recruit and the moderate doesn't. We're always going to get this withdrawal of support. And again, we're always going to end up with intervention. Or sorry, we're always going to end up with no intervention. And this is sort of the intuition that these cohesive groups are going to sort of generate some internal turmoil to deter intervention. So again, relative to complete information, we're getting less intervention. And I think we're getting still more terror. Or at least we're not intervening against some groups that we would intervene against with complete information. We're going to sort of get some mistakes, in a sense. So just some quick comments. So I think these are the only equilibria that's probably shown formally. And I think you could do more to sell that there's sort of some very novel and interesting signaling dynamics here, in that we have kind of two actors, and the signaling is sort of the joint outcome of what they do. I think that's somewhat different, and that sort of leads to some of the interesting results. I think the most interesting result here is, so sort of less surprisingly, we will get less terror with complete information or this commitment to intervene. This just sort of comes out of very kind of standard deterrence logic. We have tons of papers about, you know, if I can commit with an alliance that I'm gonna defend my ally, then that's gonna sort of deter conflict. That's I think a little more standard. The more interesting one is that you can actually get less terror by committing to no intervention. This I think is probably the best finding of the paper. And the logic here is that you're going to be removing the incentive for this moderate to recruit to stave off the extremist. And so we're actually getting more terror by committing to doing nothing, by sort of removing some of the perverse incentives of the internal group politics. So that's neat. So I was able to successfully, so I convinced Stefan before to change the name of the paper. So I'm going to try and convince you to change the name of the paper too. And actually I've changed my mind. You also just need to change the order of the title. Like foreign policy is challenging for a lot of reasons. I've never had to do it myself, but it seems pretty hard. And so I think the title should be something like, you know, the challenges of foreign policy with internally divided state groups. You know, like rather than just foreign policy's hard. So that's that. So a few thoughts on the motivation in addition to what I said before. So you talk a little bit, you know, about ISIS and Boko Haram. Obviously there's some important debates about how to deal with these groups. But in the model, there's two things which are somewhat conflated, which is partially reasonable, which is that you're conflating sort of extremism and willing to attack the West. But I think certainly in the case of ISIS, and I think Boko Haram as well, those are kind of actually off diagonal cases on this continuum, right? These are sort of extremely violent groups, but which may actually not have any ambitions to attack the West. So maybe be careful about in the motivation, but you can also think about what really matters in this model is that there are some factions who are more apt to do things that the politician doesn't want, or the potential intervener doesn't want. Now, potential intervener, you know, could be a foreign person who cares mostly about, do you have ambitions to attack the West? That foreign power could also be a local politician who just sort of wants to prevent any extremism. So I think in a way you can sort of make some of this a little bit more general and clarify this part a bit. So a few other thoughts. So I think in the way the model plays out now, we're always going to resolve the uncertainty at the end, right? And so a lot of these counterterrorism campaigns are obviously very long. And so if you want to think about, you know, what would happen maybe in a repeated setting, if this is actually tractable, I don't know if it's tractable, but you could maybe argue that you're going to sort of endogenously maybe get more uncertainty over time as, you know, maybe there's more power struggles within the group. So, you know, I don't think this sort of implies that what you say only matters at the beginning. But you could also maybe get an interesting dynamic where these informational issues may be particularly acute, maybe after you kill the leader of a terrorist group. And so this can actually get at maybe a drawback of killing leaders of terrorist groups, is that you're going to exacerbate the informational problem when you potentially have a new leader. So that could be interesting to model as well. So another thing, if you sort of go through this complete information case, then another natural question to ask is, okay, how much would the politician pay to learn what the types are? So you can think that maybe a lot of what's going on with intelligence gathering is that we want to sort of figure out this type distribution to remove these informational problems. So that would be an interesting thing to analyze as well. Then a few kind of more smaller modeling points. Both of these sort of costly conflict events of intervention and withdrawing support are just sort of very discrete, so which sort of raises the question of what happens if there's maybe transfer payments or something. I don't have any obvious intuitions for how this would screw things up, but it's worth thinking about. And then so finally, so you're this may just be because this is the way to sort of solve the model easily. You're assuming that the returns to local terror are linear, but then global terror is concave. I would think sort of intuitively that the opposite assumption would actually make more sense. That maybe local terror sort of has sort of heavy diminishing returns because you kind of run out of targets. So global terror might want to, if you can model global terror as linear and local is diminished, that might be more natural. So I'm done. So I was going to put this first, but I wasn't sure I was going to have time. So I think, so Scott's already seen this, but everyone who discusses formal papers needs to read this paper by Kieran Healy called Fuck Nuance. Nuance is not inherently bad, but you're saying that we need to avoid sort of like calls to make theories richer and more sophisticated by doing more things. That's sort of bad, and we should probably be suggesting to people how to streamline and simplify models rather than how to make them more complicated. So my proposal for a norm moving forward is that for every suggested extension, you have to suggest a way to streamline things. And I think I follow that here. And so I'll stop now.
So what's the role of communication? I mean, it's shut down, but basically it looks like, you know, the interesting case you have that, you know, you're going to create a conflict within group in order to deter intervention from so it could be, I don't know whether it was going to be killed or not, but basically if you allow communication with the sort of like the elite and the incoming politician and they cannot discuss the types, it clearly like it seems that both would have like an incentive to communicate. I'm not sure whether like in the other cases like the elite will have incentives also to sort of like provide negative information, therefore it's how credible is that, you know, like that's what I have to think about more. But basically I'm wondering whether that interesting case, you know, breaks down the moment like both have incentives and actually they can credibly communicate. I think that's pretty important, and I don't know whether you...
I mean, so in the equilibria they're there, right? They're not, you have a lot of trouble getting credible communication because essentially in the cohesive case, the extremist wants to say, hey, I'm moderate.
Sure.
In the other case, the moderate wants to say, hey, I'm extremist. And I mean, they're having to signal it through a coffee signal. It's essentially a model where you have two senders and a receiver, and the sender sends a coffee signal. So if you would allow them to communicate, like cheap, just send a cheap dog message to the politician, one type would always want to lie, and so that would. Thank you.
So in the motivation, you started by presenting, by mentioning non-state actors. And then going through the model, it wasn't clear to me exactly why this is a model of non-state actor and cannot be applied to rogue states or things like that. What is your
thought? In terms of the model, there's nothing particular about it that makes it only applicable to non-state actors. It could be a state, right? Like another example would be a leader who faces a coup plot, and he's using the same kind of, like Saddam Hussein, right? He goes and pisses off the United States so that the elites say, okay, well, we better support him, otherwise the United States is going to come in. Right? You could, the same logic would apply.
Yes. A question about, it seems like a lot of the results are coming from, you might call sort of the political process within this group, the sequencing where there's a, you know, one group gets to make this investment decision, but then the final resource distribution comes after this sort of coup decision. And I would imagine that even small changes to that, you know, sequencing or that sort of would have a huge effect on the results. So it's almost as though, and I'm wondering how much we really know about how that really works. I mean, that's a profound fact about how the internal dynamics of these kinds of organizations. So we've got this politician who can't tell whether they're extremist or moderate, but has a very subtle understanding of the way their internal politics works and their control, how these factions control over internal resources. So I don't know, I'm wondering if you can sort of say something about that. Where is the motivation coming from? How much do we know about this? And, you know, what if it's that's just not how the dynamics of internal control over resources really works?
In terms of the modeling choices, we wanted to keep it very simple. We looked at other ways in which the internal politics of that group could. So if you do it with some, if they have the ability to bargain with each other, right, then they're not going to get into a conflict with each other unless you have some other kind of thing. So then we were looking at, okay, well, what if there's a probabilistic effort? They have to put in an effort to try to overthrow the leader, and then the results end up being pretty much the same as long as the margin of return to that effort is high enough. And so we were motivated mostly by, you're right, we don't really understand how these groups react. And I think that the main point that the model is trying to get at is, let's just think about that internal political dynamic in a very coarse way in terms of, because the model is engineered that ideological division will lead to conflict unless something else produces a common ground. And the argument is that the threat of international intervention is providing this common ground in this very coarse way, is pushing that these groups do have complicated internal political dynamics. We don't fully understand them, but even in a very simple kind of way of thinking about them, international foreign policy from international actors has a profound effect on that internal political dynamic, which means that's an added challenge to understanding how these internal politics work. But I think, I'm not saying that I've got the, this is how they all work, I'm just trying to keep it very simple. You see, we're producing perverse effects on the internal political dynamic.
To the extent we believe there is a strong delegation structure within groups.
That there's some conflict over how the resources are allocated that without something else will cause a power struggle.
It's not just conflict, it's that there exists a precise delegation relationship. At the beginning, there's someone in charge who makes a decision, and there's someone else entitled with the power of removing these people from
charge.
Right.
I mean, I think
charge.
Perhaps the best way to interpret it is, and it was actually, I think Andrew suggested it, it's a drone strike. It takes out who the leader is. That was sort of known because the group's been around for a bit. Whoever was sort of second under that leader is going to allocate the resources right away, but then there's going to be some haggling over, okay, what are we going to do now that our leader is gone? I think that's the right kind of frame. Like, you don't really know what's going to happen. There may be some struggle, but somebody was initially in control. And we were very careful to use terminology of factions. It's not individuals, because then it's kind of weird.
John Gill.
I'm just wondering if you could say a bit more about Andrew's point about how long you expect the uncertainty about what's going on within the group to even maybe matter, right? So, I mean, you've got these moderate guys telling the outside interveners, oh, you know, don't worry, we've got the crazies under control, right? But at some point, you start waiting for stuff to blow up, right?
Right.
And then, so would they even have an incentive? So that's a piece of information that in your setting they don't use, the fact that you can infer something about what's going on within the group by the scale or the type of attack. And so would they, in a more longer-term setting, would they have the incentive to use political information about the group as opposed to simply waiting and see if something blows up and starts back, if not?
So on some level, if they knew exactly right, if it was basically complete information, the model would be very...
What information would they prefer to use in a longer setting? Do they want to use information about the attacks that actually happened? Or the information about the internal politics that they might be able to derive or infer from
like
internal
action reports?
Or from their decision to...
Right, if they see
little
terror attacks and they're able to track it back, then they're going to be able to back it out. Or even if they... stop plots that they're able to say.
I mean, because they can observe the outcomes of the guy's actions or their actions to recruit.
So a lot of the setup of the model was motivated by, it actually takes a starting group a very long time to disperse these operatives. I mean, Al-Qaeda took like a decade to do it. And so I agree that I don't think the model has like a long term in terms of like 20 years. Eventually, if they want to try to implement global terror, they're going to try to do it, and then you're going to be able to figure it out very quickly to just say, okay, they tried, so it must be whoever's controlling the resources. And I think that, although it's not in the model, the effect of drones is affecting that a lot in these groups, because we don't know, because the leadership of the group's changing a lot. The Bin Laden was in control for a long time, and even then it was like, okay, well, the guy that took over after, he kind of knew who he was and what he was doing. But I think this model is really trying to address... We're in a post-Al-Qaeda world, to some extent. There are a lot of these groups all over. If you go to the Wikipedia page just to see how many groups are in Syria, it's surprisingly long. How many different groups? And then you just start clicking. There's very little known about most. I mean, now ISIS has taken over the attention, but there's still like 60-some-odd groups, but it's not really clear. they have some religious element, but how extremist are they? Just because they're Islam doesn't mean they're what we call extremists. So I think that it has a longer time horizon than might be initially suggested. But.
Yes, Kelly.
Right. Scott, I'm still struggling a little with Andrew's comment about that eventually you'd figure out, eventually you'd get to full information. And if I think about the historical context, right, the British were always complaining, the British were occupying Palestine, were always complaining that the Jews pretended to be factions, but actually they were just using tactics. And they were playing good cop, bad cop. Israel and Hamas had the same relationship. It was an ongoing, but all the cell phones are listened to, all the cell phone conversations are listened to, and yet there's still a debate about whether a unified Hamas versus moderates and extremists. Is it possible that a group that was really totally homogeneous could successfully behave as if it were factionalized, kind of in your model, and keep this going forever?
I think that's certainly possible. It might be more challenging now that, okay, we're going in and we're listening to their phone calls. They would have to be much, they would have to be very conscious that this is what they're doing. And the model that would suggest that that's what they would try to do. And this cohesive group that say, we're all on the same page and we all want to do it, but we really need to project an image of division because otherwise we're just going to invite intervention. This is like all outside the model, right? But they would benefit from putting effort forward to try to keep that equilibrium going.
I love the bottom line of the models crafted to get the point that we can be trapped into becoming victims of terrorism because the expectation that we're going to react forces society to follow this strategy of attacking us is an important one. Maybe the model is crafted for that, but it bothers me. There's something that seems wrong about a model that start with assumptions of a model may be, you know, instrumental to what conclusions we're trying to highlight, but at a fundamental level, starting with an assumption that the leader of a group might be an extremist or might be a moderate seems to be putting the question the wrong way. That I'd rather assume, obviously, if there's global terrorism going on, there must be demand for it. So that means, so for example, there could be people who are really angry about something, and the people are willing to volunteer the young men are willing to volunteer to risk their lives for a good cause at a certain stage in life might be something you take as axiomatic. I prefer to have the leaders be people who are in the model as being people who simply want power. They'd like to have followers. And now the question is, if you want, you know, can you find a niche where if you follow a certain, say, people come follow me, we'll be in a certain, you know, coordinated in a certain kind of strategy. Is that a good tactic for gaining support? The attack on the September 11th attack 14 years ago in this country, it was a group, Al-Qaeda was a group that was in the business of taking Arabs volunteers and getting them to fight in Afghanistan. So that meant they had to move people, which meant they had to be, now the war on the Soviets in Afghanistan ended, and those guys still that were in that business, so they wanted to keep it going. And the idea, well, let's tell Saudis that we'll try to get the Saudis who are angry about the United States having a base there, that we'll do terrorism on against the, you know, come work for us and you can become a way of affecting the political change that you want in Saudi Arabia. Well, that required a global terrorism because they're sitting in Afghanistan, they're trying to recruit in Saudi Arabia. You have to do it, you have to get into the newspaper, the global newspapers. But I don't think anybody wakes up in the morning wanting to blow somebody up halfway across the world. So I wish we could start thinking instead about maybe a model where there are certain people who have demand for certain kinds of political change, whether in their country or in, you know, and when does a leader find an advantageous tactic to pose as to say, come work for me and I'll get you involved in violence. And where do you want the violence? But it's who are you advertising to? Because most political actors are trying to get power in their neighborhood, and it's pretty safe to say that whatever violence they do will be in the same neighborhood where they operate. and where their recruits are, and it's only when somebody's trying to fill a niche of recruiting globally that they would want to commit global terror. Of course, let's just say one other thing. You start with non-state regions, and of course, one of the problems if I want to advertise globally, the global terror can be a global recruitment tool only if people who are far away from me are going to come to me, which means that they have to be able to find me. But if people halfway around the world can find me, then so can policemen who are actually operating in my neighborhood. So you can't have policemen operating in my neighborhood, which is why it has to be the non-state void becomes a place where this kind of global terror. I think that comes out of that approach.
In terms of, maybe this is like the way we worded it a bit, we're agnostic about why people want to do terrorism or not. I think it's probably in a footnote now, but now I'm guessing it should probably be much more pronounced. We're just saying some people, perhaps due to comparative advantage, want to keep power and do their stuff, and they're going to use terrorism, their tactic to do that. Other people, they're not going to do that. They have other means that they're going to do, and we're just trying to keep. Once we have this distinction between them, I mean, I guess using the term extremist, it makes it seem like we're just saying they just want to get up and blow people up. We're just saying they have some political goal that we're agnostic about, and they're going to use this tactic to do that. So I think in some sense that's an excellent point, but it's, we need to package things.
At some point, there's an endogeneity to why. Right. Why would somebody be sitting in a particular area wanting to organize in that location an attack on the United States, which is an ocean away? Why would that happen? The answer is sometimes it does happen, but usually it doesn't happen. That people are actively organizing to commit terror in the United States, and they're doing it here, even though the United States isn't. They're not in the United States. People in the United States might want to. You have to worry about all the time, but you don't usually have to worry about somebody in another continent wants to organize as a non-state actor to attack you. We should recognize there are certain kinds of circumstances with very special where that might be a good tactic for building an organization, but usually it's not.
I'm confused by your question, Hunter.
Yeah.
So it seems to me this is like a reduced form version of an assumption like inside an organization, we observe there's people who are going to be advocates for one tactic and people who are going to be advocates for another tactic. Here we're going to call them global terrorism and local terrorism, right? And why do we think that's true? Well, so you want to say it's not because of like fundamental preferences, because they all care about power. So they're a different information set, so they have different comparative advantage or something, right? They're different in some ways that leads them to. And I agree that like that's got to be endogenous somewhere deep down in the model, right? But that doesn't strike me as a good argument for not having a model which says let's treat that in a reduced form way and say given that we have those divisions.
I accept that you assuming that the assumption that there might be a person in a country who's organizing a faction to commit terrorism in America, even though this is far from America, is. It's happened, so it's possible. So you put it in the model as a reduced form. I'm agreeing, but I'm saying it's endogenous. It when you start looking for why does it happen, that's not assuming it, but making it a derived result from something more fundamental, that anybody who's leading a faction must desire to lead. You know, a better model of a leader of a faction is he wants to lead a faction. He wants to recruit support, resources, and individuals to come work for him. And you have to ask, why would the costly activity of planting people to commit terror continental oceans and continents removed from where you're sitting, which is very complicated, much harder than political action in your neighborhood. Why would that be a beneficial strategy? It could be a beneficial strategy if you just wake up in the morning wanting to. And Osama bin Laden said, "I just wanted to bring down the looming towers." No bullshit. He didn't want to. I mean, it was. If you look at his lifestyle, it was actually an adaptive to more natural goals, other than people had a dream and suddenly wanted to bring down the Twin Towers. No, it was there was something else going on, and so I think that then constrains the model, because you're not allowed to put a theta equals one at any old place. You can only put theta equals one where other stuff is going on that makes it a good tactic for some, that's it constrains where we put the theta equals one terrorist type, because we're deriving it from something else. It says people who just want to be politicians might find it useful if nobody else is organizing terror operations against America. Wow, that'd be a great way to recruit, to get lots of people to give money and their lives to you if you start doing that. Well, no, usually it isn't a great way to do it.
I think Ethan's saying, fuck bullshit.
Yeah.